On the 20th of July in 1639, in the village of Gallehus, near the town of Møgeltønder, a poor Danish woman by the name of Kirsten Svendsdatter was on her way into the town to sell her lace, when she suddenly stumbled over something on the ground. At first, she thought it was just a tree root sticking out from the ground, but at a closer look, she could see there was something shining underneath the dirt. She reached out for it and pulled it out from the ground. She then sat down on the ground and started turning it around in her hands while brushing the dirt off. She then realized that she just discovered something extraordinary, a long golden horn made out of solid gold that was worth more than she could ever dream of to make in her entire lifetime. She brought the golden horn home with her and wrote a letter to Christian IV, who was the king of Denmark. The Danish king owned all the rights to all the gold that was found in the soil in Denmark, something that is called Danefæ, a law that is actually still in effect today. But instead of the royal family receiving the fines, it has to be handed in to the government, who then hands out a reward based on the value of the objects. Unfortunately for Kirsten, she was only given a skirt by the king as a reward, but I really hope that this was one kind of remarkable skirt for this great find, and I do really think that the king should probably also have given her some silver coins as well. The horn was 75.8 centimeters long and weighed approximately 3.1 kilos. The horn consisted of two layers. On the inside, it was made of gold alloy that was mixed together with silver. And on the outside of the long horn, it was decorated with rings made of pure gold. On the upper seven rings, the horn was decorated with figures of animals, humans, and other symbols. Some of them were punched, while other figures were salted. On the 21st of April in 1734, and almost 100 years later, and just about 15 to 20 meters away from where the first golden horn was found, there was found a second horn by a man named Erik Lassen, who was out in the fields digging for clay. This golden horn was a bit shorter, but a little bit wider than the other one that was discovered in 1639. Erik traveled to Schjalkenborg Castle and delivered the golden horn to the Jarl, who then gave him 200 ristalas as a reward. Ristalas was coins made from silver, and it was one of the several currencies that was used in Denmark until 1875. 200 ristalas was a lot of money in the 18th century. And to give you an idea how much it was, 200 ristalas was equivalent to about 800 to 900 days of work. Since all the gold still technically belonged to the king, the horn was then delivered to Christiansborg Castle in Copenhagen. This short horn was 71.3 centimeters long, but it is estimated that the short horn could have had the same length as the long horn. This horn was a bit heavier and weighed approximately 3.7 kilos, but we can never be certain. The horn was made from the same materials as the first one, and as I said, it is believed it used to have the same length as the first long horn, but this horn was probably damaged by the plowing through the years, and the missing piece has most likely been melted down a long time ago. This horn was divided into five rings, and within each of these five rings, there were decorations with figures. In the top of the horn, unlike the other horn, it has a runic inscription that was written with the Elder Fula runes, a runic language that was primarily used before the Viking Age. There's been made two translations of this. The first one is, "I, Aegist, son of Hold, made this horn." The second translation was made by Finn Rasmussen, and it reads, "I, guest of the living, from Hold, the horn I have made." We are absolutely certain that this is not a Viking horn, since it was not written with the younger Thudag, which was the runes that were used in the Viking Age. But the inscription is written, as I said, with the elder Thudag, and the depictions do also not fit within the Viking Age. The two golden horns have been dated to the early 5th century, which was the period in time that is known as the Germanic Iron Age. The archaeologists are convinced that these horns were made in Denmark, due to the technique of how the horns were made. And the ornaments have also been seen in other Nordic designs before. The inscription on the short horn also seems to indicate that it was made in the southwestern part of Denmark. It is possible that these horns were sacrificed to the gods in the 5th century, when a group of Anglos immigrated from the southern parts of Jutland to the British Isles. We do not know what the horns' original use were, but by judging from their appearance, they could have been used in a religious context, and maybe they were also used by a jarl or a king during the Viking Age. However, if they were used as a drinking horn or as an instrument is something that we simply do not know for certain. The images on the horns can be linked to myths from the Mediterranean, as well as to Nordic myths, and perhaps also Celtic myths. These horns have been subjected to numerous attempts to interpret them. The interpretation of the images depends on three questions. Should the images be read as a coherent account from the mouthpiece? Does it describe a ceremony, or is it a story? And where in the picture rings does the text start? The first attempt to interpret the longhorn was made by the German professor Ole Worm in 1641, when he described the first golden horn in his book De Auro Corno. He was of the opinion that the longhorn was a war horn, dating back to King Frode. And the images were an admonition to how the people should act in regards to each other. It probably goes without saying that he and many others looked at the depictions with a Christian mindset. The archaeologist J.J.R. Worsaae was of another opinion, and he wrote in 1880 that the depictions on the longhorn illustrated Helheim, which is the underworld in Norse mythology, and he speculated that they depicted the saga about Balder's death. The stars on the short horn represented, according to him, the houses in Asgard where Odin, Thor and Freya lived. In 1949, the Swede Lars Ivar Ringbums, who probably was high on meatballs at the time, were of the opinion that the images showed situations and performances from pagan party games. Thus, the images were to portray the great joy of the return of spring, where the people dressed up for a parade as they do at carnivals. In 1969, Willy Hartner, who was a historian of science in the city of Frankfurt in Germany, tried to decipher the two rows of images in the top of the segment of the longer horn. And according to him, the figures should be translated into, "May I, the potion of this horn, bring help to the clan." It is difficult to say what exactly they illustrate, and there has been made many more interpretations than I care to list here. We should also be careful not to make guesses and read something into it. An interpretation of the longhorn that was published in July 2017 by Finn Rasmussen has, in my eyes, the best explanation of what these images on the longhorn really are symbolizing. I won't go into details on all the symbols, but just the main ones, so you will be able to understand his interpretation of the longhorn. If we start by looking at the figures at the top of the longhorn, we see two rows that have 12 figures each. According to Finn Rasmussen and Jens Juel Jensen, these figures are based on an old Germanic language, which is called Gothic. When we decipher the text, then it translates into the following. I am the immortal. I guide you. According to Finn Rasmussen, it is essential to understand the inscription on the longhorn to be able to decipher the rest of the decoration on the horn. Finn Rasmussen also proposes that there is a difference between the upper and the lower figures. The upper illustrations are supposed to indicate the good and guide the man in the right direction in his life. And the figures beneath are indicating evil, shown with men in chains, which indicate what happens to those who choose to go down the evil path in life. The double snake represents an immortal and invisible spirit that is punctured in order to show its invisibility. This snake appears many times on the longhorn because it is observing man throughout life and guiding him on a path. The rest of the figures on the rings should be read from the bottom of the horn and up. If we take a look at the depiction on ring 7, we see a conception, which is symbolized with two human bones, which might be the bones of an ancestor who is going to be reborn. On the sixth ring, the figures illustrate the fetus, which is symbolized as a plant with a bud. At birth, the flower will bloom. On ring 5, we see the newborn together with his parents, who are playing a board game. The fish in the left side is symbolizing the child striving towards the next stage in its life. On the fourth ring, we see a worker who is symbolized as a figure with an axe and a digging stick in his hands. These tools were quite common at the time for both men and women. The third ring is depicting a ruler, which is symbolized with a human wheel. The idea behind this human wheel figure is when one ruler falls, another ruler will take its place. The second ring is symbolizing the transition to the afterlife. Here we see a spirit riding on a horse to meet its goddess. At their arrival, it is greeted with a horn filled with the elixir of life. Just like the longhorn, there's been made many attempts to decipher the shorthorn. One of these attempts was made in 1969 by the same Willy Hartner, as I mentioned before. Willy Hartner proposed that the figures were representing constellations, and he claimed that the images and symbols were referring to a lunar eclipse that happened on the 4th of November in 412, and it also depicted a solar eclipse on the 16th of April in 413. Finn Rasmussen has also written his thoughts about this shorthorn, and again, I like his interpretation the best. Just like before, I will not go into details on all the figures, since there are just too many and the depth of the meaning will just take too long to explain. I have already talked about the meaning of the runes on this horn, so I will continue just below on the first ring. According to Finn Rasmussen, this first part represents the Germanic heaven. One of the figures that stood quite out notable to me was the figures with the horns. These are the gods, and they are referred to as the divine twins. They are naked and have no sex because gods does not need to have a certain sex. The helmets with the horns are meant to illustrate power and signalize the power of creation. The divine twin to the left is the god of life and growth, which is symbolized with the ring that symbolizes the circle of life, and a wand that symbolizes an object that will revive you and bring you back to life again. The twin also has a spear in its hand, which stands for strength and courage. The divine tree to the right is the god of death and harvest, which is symbolized by the sickle. Maybe the grim reaper that has been depicted many times in Christianity has its roots in old Germanic paganism. The twin also uses a stick in the other hand to guide people through the realm of the dead. It is possible that the religious leaders of the society dressed up as the gods when they performed the rituals. There has been found helmets that look very similar in Denmark, dating back to the Bronze Age. These helmets with horns were found at Veksø on Skjalden in Denmark, and they are estimated to date back to around 1000 BCE, which would put them in the middle of the Bronze Age. However, if they were used at religious ceremonies or only as offerings at the box, is something we can only speculate about today. When the Germanic tribe known as Angles settled on the British Isles, they probably brought their culture with them, as people so often do. This tribe originated from what today is Denmark and Germany. But this area has mainly been part of the Danish territories throughout history. One of the reasons why I think they probably brought the culture with them is because of the helm that was found at the Sutton ship monument that dates back to around the beginning of the 7th century. This is a replica of the helmet, and here you can see it more clearly. And the resemblance of the two twins is remarkably close to those that were depicted on the golden shorthorn from Gallehus. It is also possible that these ancient depictions of the divine twins refer to the two Vanir twins, Freya and Freya, who are the children of Injor in Norse mythology. If true, then these gods and goddesses seem to get thousands and thousands of years older every time we discover new objects in the soil from our ancient ancestors. While the worship of the divine twins seem to have been common for all the Germanic tribes, and possibly also under different names from area to area, they were not gods that seem to have been particularly Germanic. The concept of the divine twins are also known in other cultures. The Romans were also familiar with them, something that can be seen on the wall paintings in the ruins of Pompeii in Italy. However, the names were not the divine twins to the Romans, but they were called Castor and Pollux. These two were twin half-brothers in both the Greek and the Roman mythology. The concept of the divine twins can also be found in Hinduism. Nara-Narayana are two twin sage brothers, and they are to some devotees considered the fourth incarnation of Lord Vishnu. If there is a connection between neo-paganism and Hinduism, or if this is just a coincidence, is not something I can answer, and it would require a lot more research on the topic. But again, we should be careful not to read something into it. The two warriors are not the depictions of the common man. They are the leaders and the chieftains of the society. The sword was an expensive weapon, and only the people with vast amount of wealth could afford to purchase or have such a sword made. The two warriors are also equipped with a gold necklace, which was also a symbol of high status, and only something that has been found in graves of the leaders of their time. For those of you who have a keen eye, you might have noticed the symbol that looks very much like the Aegishjalmr symbol. This is a defense symbol, and it is supposed to strike fear into the hearts of the enemies, and thus protect you from any harm. If this is indeed this symbol, it raises another question, and that is, how old is this symbol really? And what does it mean in this context? According to Finn Rasmussen, the other four rings on the shorthorn depicts the same stages of life as the longhorn. But unlike the images on the longhorn that describes the behavior of the individual and their inner life. This shorthorn describes a stage of the human life, which he calls the giving force, the force of dedication, and the receiving force. You might have noticed that I was talking about these golden horns as something of the past, and that is unfortunate because in the darkness of the night on May 4th in 1802, the golden horns were stolen from the Royal Chamber of Art in Copenhagen. The next day, when the theft was discovered, there was put a huge reward of 1,000 rigsdaler in all the Danish papers to anyone who had some information that could lead to the arrestment of the thief. The thief, who would turn out to be a poor goldsmith and watchmaker by the name Niels Heidenreich, wiped out the golden horns' original appearance and their cultural importance when he one night melted them down and turned the gold into useless junk. Niels tried to sell the earrings and the coins that he had made from the gold, but because he had mixed the coins with brass, he was eventually caught for fraud, which led him to confess where he had gotten the gold from. Niels was sentenced and he spent the next 37 years in prison. Today, we only know how the horns looked from drawings that were made between the 17th and the 18th century by Ole Worm and Pauli. And because of this, we are a bit unsure of some of the details. If these horns were intended as drinking horns or blowing horns is simply something we do not know. Although, I think it is safe to say that these horns belong to someone with a massive amount of wealth or a very high status. However, there's no doubt that drinking horns were used for rituals by the Germanic tribes. And there has been found plenty of drinking horns in almost all graves of all the important people from this time period. Julius Caesar also wrote about how the Germanic tribes hunted ur-ox in the first century in order to get their hands on these horns. The horns differ very much from those of our oxen in size and shape and kind. The Germanic tribes collect them eagerly, encase their edges in silver, and use them as beakers at the most magnificent banquets. Since we do not have the originals, it is uncertain if the golden horns were curved or whether they had a winding helix-like curvature, like a natural ox horn. Besides the fact that they could have been used as drinking horns, we do also know that blowing horns were used both before and during the Viking Age. And the god Heimdall is also known to have a horn which is called Gjallarhorn. Heimdall is the god that guards the rainbow bridge, known as Bifrost, and he will use this horn during Ragnarok to warn all the gods and goddesses that the final battle has begun, and they should put on their war gear and gather their huge armies so they can travel to the battleground at Vigrid, where they will be meeting the Jotuns and the army of the dead. In 1861, two new replicas of the golden horns of Gallehus were made by the orders of Frederick VII of Denmark, who then donated them to the museum. However, these replicas were not in the right size and were also not curved as some of the archaeologists believe. In 1978, two additional copies were made, and these did have the right size and were also curved, to some of the researchers' satisfaction. In 1993, the two golden horns were stolen again, and this time from the Moesgaard Museum in Jutland, but they were recovered shortly after because they were made of glittered brass and had no value beside the historical aspect. In the early morning on September 17, in 2007, replicas of these horns were stolen for a third time. This time, it was from a museum in the town of Jelling. These copies were made from glittered silver, but luckily for those of us who like history, they were recovered 2 days later on September 19. The Gallehus horns have inspired many artists throughout history, and they have been used in a wide range of designs, such as on porcelain figurines, cups, stamps, matchboxes, apple cider bottles, statues, drawings, paintings, and possibly also on the painting The Golden Horn by Theodor Kittelsen. If you want to see these gold horns for yourself, you can do so at the Danish National Museum in Copenhagen. There's also a copy at the Moesgaard Museum in northern Jutland, just outside the city of Aarhus. If you're unable to travel to Europe to see one of these replicas of the Golden Horns, you can see a copy if you are in the USA and go to the Juno Park in Milwaukee. Here there is a bronze sculpture of Leif Erikson that was created in 1887 by the artist Anne Whitney. In the right hand, Leif is holding one of these golden horns from Gallehus. There's another replica of this bronze sculpture in Boston, Massachusetts, at the Commonwealth Avenue at Charles Gate East. I hope you liked the video, and if you did, please give it a thumbs up. Feel free to share the video with a friend that you think might like it. See you next time for another video. Thank you for watching.